Welcome to the introduction. We will speak about several aspects before speaking about shock absorber. The first aspect is the shock absorber and the suspension. It is very important to define the reason why there are different types of shock absorbers with different dimensions and different features. So, let's start defining what the suspension is. The suspension is the group of parts connecting the wheel with the frame of the car and regulating the relative movement of the frame versus the wheel and vice versa. The main components of the suspension are the tire, the wheel, the arms, the spring, different types of spring, the shock absorber, and so on. We will see all of them. And we will see many different types of shock absorber. This will help us to understand why there are different types of shock absorbers too. The most simple type of shock suspension are trailing arms. This is a very simple suspension that you can find, for instance, on Fiat 500 and Fiat 600 produced during the 18th and the 19th. As you can see, it's just an arm connected in two different points. In this way, you have a simple movement. If the connection is not perpendicular with the axle of the car, like in this case, with the movement of the wheel, the toe in and the toe out and other parameters of the wheel will change with the movement. This is the most simple type of suspension. Another type of suspension are the trailing arms. In this case, the arms are linked between them thanks to a sort of torsion bar. I say a sort of torsion bar because the bar is not connected to the frame, so is flexing more than torquing. So is a sort of torsion bar. The main feature of this suspension is that you have two independent suspensions moving around bearings. The wheels are moving up and down. They are connected each other through this sort of torsion bar. And then there is a shock absorber and a spring. The shock absorber is used to be very close to the bearings, so quite far away from the wheel. And for this reason, the shock absorber is very small. And of course, must be also very hard. And the rod could be quite big, like for instance, 16 millimeters. We will see these details later. Then there is the elastic element, the spring. In many cases, there is a coil spring, like in this picture, as was used to be on all Fiat, Lancia, Alfa Romeo from 18th and 19th. So let me say Fiat Punto, first series, Fiat Bravo, Lancia Delta, second series, Lancia Vedra, Alfa Romeo 145, 146, and so on. A similar suspension was common on Renault and Peugeot too, but in this case, the coil spring was substituted by torsion bars. Another suspension very common is the torsion beam suspension. Here you see probably the first application of this suspension made on Volkswagen Golf first series. While this is the evolution that you can find on Volkswagen Golf 4 series. Let me explain how it works. As you see, there are two arms, one per side, but each arm is connected to the other through a torsion beam. and they are welded together. So the torsion bar is, in this case, is bigger and weld to the arms. So at the end, it is only one piece that is torquing a lot. For this reason, it's called torsion beam suspension. Then it is connected to the frame with elastic components. So there is a torsion also of rubber connections. In this case, the shock absorber has the same arm of the wheel, and it is used to be in vertical position. So the shock absorber, in comparison with the previous example, is longer. Is also thinner because forces are lower than before. The rod is very small, around 12 millimeters, 12.5, and the shock absorber is much more soft. In the first version of Golf 1, the coil spring and the shock absorber were mounted, were coaxial. In the evolution, they have been split, so the spring was working directly on the torsion beam. The advantage of this system is that you can separate the shock absorber from the spring, so the spring, you will have some cylinder blocks working only on static forces and other working only on dynamic forces. It means that since the cylinder block of the shock absorber will work only with the forces of the shock absorber, could be softer than in this case, where has to support also the forces of the coil spring. So being softer, since the cylinder block in this case is softer than in this case, can absorb better the high frequencies vibration and improve the comfort of the car. Wishbone suspension is probably the oldest suspension that we can have in mind, because it has, I don't know, maybe 70, 80, 90 years of history. It is very simple. If you see it from front, you will see this image, while from the top you will see two triangles. Of course, if it is a front wheel, there must be also a fifth arm for steering, while if it is a rear wheel, there must be a fifth arm avoiding the wheel's move. The big advantage of this suspension is that you can make the project and make the triangles as you want in order to change the position of the tire with the movement of the frame respect the tire, and change the toe in, the toe out, and so on. For this reason, this is the suspension used on racing cars like Formula, and was also the suspension used on cars with longitudinal engine. Of course, if you put the engine in a transversal position, you don't have space anymore for this kind of solution, so you are obliged to use different solutions. A different solution could be the multilink. Multilink is very similar to wishbones. You have a triangle in the lower level and something similar in the upper level. The difference is that you are changing the connection point in order to adapt the suspension to the other components of the car, like the frame, the fuel tank, the seats of the passengers, the van where you have to put all the things, that are a priority in comparison with the suspension. This solution appeared more or less on the 18th, especially on Japanese cars, and then also in German and other kind of cars. The MacPherson. It is very important to define what a MacPherson is, because there is a lot of confusion about. So, let me start from wishbone suspension, okay? One triangle, the hub, the other triangle, the coil spring and the shock absorber and the frame. The main feature of wishbone suspension is that the shock absorber is working only as an absorber of vibration. In this case, the shock absorber has any structural function. What does it mean? It means that if I remove the shock absorber, nothing will change. The car will bump a lot, but can be driven with a big difference, but can be driven. What a MacPherson is? A MacPherson is little bit similar to wishbones, because we have the lower arm, the hub, but this triangle is disappeared. And in exchange of the triangle, we have a shock absorber that is connected in a rigid way to the hub. Rigid way means that there are at least two bolts with two nuts. So the shock absorber and the hub is only one piece. In certain cases, they are even welded together. It means that if the hub moves 1 centimeter, the shock absorber moves 1 centimeter at the same time, at the same speed, with the same arm. And if I remove the shock absorber, the frame gets down. Why? Because in this case, the shock absorber has a structural function. Okay? Without the shock absorber, the car cannot stand up, cannot be driven. Okay? Because that the shock absorber in a MacPherson has a big relevance, is very important, and it is a safety component. For this reason, the shock absorber on a MacPherson is much more strong and resistant than in this case. In fact, in this case, the rod is minimum 20 millimeters for a small car, 22 if it is bigger. In other cases, it's even 25, 28 millimeters. And of course, the rod inside the body continues a lot in order to be properly guided. Cannot stop here, even when completely extended, as happens in this case. So please, working with MacPherson, be always very careful, because you cannot risk to have problems. Let's speak about elastic element. First of all, what is an elastic element? An elastic element is a component that once is subjected to a force, gets deformed, and getting deformed creates a force in the opposite direction and with the same amount of the main force. But is elastic because if you remove the force, the inner force obliges the elements to return to the original dimension and shape. So an elastic element is an element that, once it's deformed, returns to the original shape and dimension. The elastic element is used in the suspension to take outer forces, to support forces like weight, and to return it. The shock absorber absorbs the forces. In this case, we don't have absorption. We take it, we transform the weight in potential energy, and then it's returned to the suspension. There are many types of elastic elements. The most simple one is the torsion bar. The torsion bar is this pink color. How does it work? It is made simply but with a bar. Here is connected to the rigidly connected to the frame, and here is rigidly connected to the triangle. It means that if the triangle moves up and down and rotates, the torsion bar is obliged to torque, and torquing creates an effort. So it's the most simple solution because it's just a bar. It is not very common currently because it's quite expensive and is quite difficult to install on the vehicle, especially if there is a big and fast production. But it's a system that is very effective and works properly in many different applications. Just to make some example, this is the suspension, the front suspension of the first Porsche 911. So it's a great solution on a sporting car like a Porsche, but has been very common also on the front wheel of Alfa Romeo 75, Alfa Romeo 90, so on big cars, but has been used very often also on the rear suspension, like on Renault 5, Renault Super 5, Renault Clio, Peugeot 106, Peugeot 205, Peugeot 306, and all production of Renault and Peugeot. It has not been used anymore because the cost, but is a pity because it was extremely effective, and moreover, the dimension was very small, so was not keeping out space for other components on the car. You can find this system also on trucks, like on Iveco Daily, or even bigger trucks. But in the last 10-15 years, it gets more and more common on Formula One. So it is a solution that can move from truck to Formula One to car, so it is a very nice solution. Please do not confuse the torsion bar with the stabilizer. The stabilizer or sway bar is a torsion bar that connects both suspension in order to reduce the rolling of the car. Please don't confuse these two different parts, sway bar and torsion bar. In this case, you connect the two suspension. In this case, you support the weight of the car. Coil spring. The coil spring is like a torsion bar, but has been coiled, and it works with the same principle of the bar. In fact, when you press the coil spring down, it's not working by flexion as people think, but is working by torsion. Okay? The 95-96% of the effort is made by torsion, not because of flexion. There are many types of coil springs. You can have the pitch constant or not. If it is not constant will be progressive. You can have different types of diameter. The diameter can be the same or can change. And the diameter of the wire can be fixed or can change. Depending on the feature of the spring, change its behaviors. In the most of the cases, the spring, the coil spring, has a constant force, or more or less constant. In order to make a suspension more progressive and then to be harder at the end of the stroke, are very common the rubber dampers. They doesn't work from the very beginning. They start working at the end, and at the end they make the suspension 3, 4, 10 times more rigid than at the beginning in order to avoid to arrive at the end of the stroke of the shock absorber. There are many other types of springs, like rubber springs or air springs, but the aim of this training is not to speak about them, so let me go ahead. It is very important to have in mind what is the level arm, because in this case you have to consider the level arm of the wheel, of the coil spring, and of the shock absorber. In this case, we have that all of these elements have the same level arm. Suppose that we have a suspension like this. All the components have the same level arms. The coil spring, the shock absorber, and the level arm. And suppose that in order to have a right suspension, you need a spring with a rigidity of like K, okay? Now the question is, how much stronger must be the coil spring if we move from here to here with the 50% of lever arm? In many cases, you will hear that if the lever arm is the 50%, the new spring must be the double. And this is wrong. This is wrong because in reality, the fact is this. The new spring must be harder than original. And because the 50% of lever arm, it must generate the double of the force, but in the middle of stroke. And to make the double of force in middle of stroke means to be 4 times harder. If the lever arm would be 1/3, the new spring should be 9 times harder than original. For this and the same thing, we can say the same thing about the shock absorber. Suppose that a shock absorber in this position works properly, generating an effort of 100 kilos. If we place the shock absorber here, the new shock absorber, in order to generate an equivalent damping effect, must be 400 kilos. And if placed here with 1/3 of lever arm, should be 900 kilos. For this reason, the shock absorber of certain cars are so hard, and in other cases are so soft. For instance, if you take the rear shock absorber of a Mercedes or BMW, they are soft. Well, if you measure the rear shock absorber of a Renault Clio first series, it is 5, 6, 7 times harder than the shock absorber of BMW, even if it is smaller, shorter, and lighter. Why? Because the lever arm on a Renault Clio first series is very, very small in comparison with the lever arm that we can have on a big BMW or Mercedes.